Hey guys, welcome back to my channel, the ENT Resident. Today I'll be discussing a disease of the year, and that is mastoiditis. Now this is important because this is a complication of chronic otitis media, and this is a very common case that you can end up seeing in your clinical practice as well. And also knowing the viva questions regarding this, because this is definitely going to come up if you have gotten a case of CSOM in your lung case. You can also now purchase my notes. I have added links in the description. Okay, let's get started. Now, mastoiditis, there are two different types of mastoiditis that we need to know about. One is acute mastoiditis and the second one is masked or latent mastoiditis. Let's first discuss acute mastoiditis. Now, what is acute mastoiditis? So we know that in a case of otitis media, it can lead to involvement of the middle ear cleft, which involves the mastoid, antrum, attic, additus, middle ear, as well as the eustachian tube. Now, when this infection spreads from the mucosa, which is lining the mastoid air cells, to involve the bony walls of the mastoid air cell system, that condition is known as acute mastoiditis. So mastoiditis is not when just the mucosa lining has been involved. It is the condition when the bony walls of the mastoid gets involved. Now, coming to etiology, acute mastoiditis is more commonly seen in cases of children. Usually, it happens as a result of or it follows an infection, which is the acute suppurative otitis media. But it can also occur following chronic otitis media as well. Now, this depends whether mastoiditis develops after acute suppurative otitis media or not. This is determined by two factors. One is the virulence of the organisms if it is very high. And second is a low resistance of patient, which means lowered immunity. If the patient is suffering from measles, exanthematous fever, or has poor nutrition, or has any other associated systemic disease like diabetes, these are all scenarios where the resistance of the patient is lowered. So in high virulence of organisms or presence of low resistance of patient, a case of acute suppurative otitis media can progress to form acute mastoiditis. Now, acute mastoiditis is often seen in mastoids which have a well-developed air cell system. The common microorganisms, the most common microorganism involved in acute mastoiditis is the beta-hemolytic streptococcus. Other than that, other organisms can be Staphylococcus aureus, Haemophilus influenzae. Now let's try to understand what is the pathophysiology behind developing acute mastoiditis. How does the disease progress? So what happens is there is an extension of the inflammatory process to involve the mucoperiosteal lining of the air cell system. Now once it has involved the whole air cell system, there is an increase in the amount of pus production that is happening, and this is because of the large surface area that is involved. Now, because there is an increase in the amount of pus production, there is a problem with the drainage of the pus. Why? Because all the pus is trying to drain through a small perforation of the tympanic membrane and or the eustachian tube. This drainage cannot keep up with the amount of pus that is getting produced. Now, when that happens, that there is more production and less drainage happening, so what will happen? The pus will start to accumulate. This will lead to swollen mucosa of the antrum and the attic. This swollen mucosa in turn will further impede the drainage system. So all of this together has led to accumulation of pus under tension. This is one aspect of it. Second is, in case of mastoiditis, we also see that there is hyperemia and engorgement of mucosa. This will lead to dissolution of the calcium from the bony walls of the mastoid air cells. When there is dissolution of calcium happening, the condition is known as hyperemic decalcification. And there is an osteoclastic resorption of the bony walls. Now this, together with the pus which has accumulated under tension, this will lead to the destruction and coalescence. Coalescence meaning a lot of things joining together. So this leads to destruction and coalescence of the mastoid air cells, converting it into a single irregular cavity which is filled with pus. At this stage, it is known as empyema of the mastoid. Now, the pus that has now accumulated in this single cavity, it can break through the mastoid cortex. In that case, it will lead to the formation of subperiosteal abscess. Now, this subperiosteal abscess that is formed, this can also further burst on the surface, leading to the developing of a discharging fistula. So this is the pathological process behind formation of mastoiditis, subperiosteal abscess, and a mastoid fistula. Now let's talk about what are the clinical features you'd be seeing in this case. Coming to symptoms first. Now symptoms will be very similar to that of acute otitis media. However, the important thing to remember here is that a change in the character of the same symptoms that you see in case of acute otitis media is significant, and that will point you to the diagnosis of acute mastoiditis. Now, what are this change in character that we'll see? First point, first symptom that is important here is pain behind the ear. Now, pain is also seen in cases of acute otitis media, but in acute otitis media, it will usually subside with either tympanic membrane perforation happening or with proper treatment with antibiotics. But whenever we see these three things, one, persistence of the pain, second, increase in the intensity of the pain, and third, recurrence of the pain after it has subsided. If any one of this happens, that would be a significant pointer of pain in acute mastoiditis. Second feature is fever. When we see that there is a persistence or recurrence of fever in a case of acute otitis media, despite adequate antibiotic treatment, that points towards the development of acute mastoiditis. Third feature is ear discharge. So, ear discharge is present even in a case of acute otitis media. But when that discharge becomes profuse and increases in its purulence, that is when we'll suspect the development of acute mastoiditis. Sometimes you can even see that the discharge can stop due to obstruction in the drainage. But you will notice that all the other symptoms that I have mentioned can end up worsening. Another feature to remember here is any persistence of ear discharge beyond 3 weeks in a case of acute otitis media will always point towards the development of mastoiditis. Last symptom here is, usually because this is more common in children, but if this is seen in cases of infants, they will present as irritable and they'll also present with feeding problems. Next, let's talk about the signs that you'll see. First, in terms of general signs, the child will be irritable, in agony, and appear flushed. There will be a low-grade fever and a rise in pulse rate. Coming to external auditory canal, two things that we'll see. One is there can be a mucopurulent or purulent discharge, which can often be pulsatile, and this is known as the lighthouse effect. This can be seen coming through the ESE through a coming into the ESE through the central perforation. So we see a pulsatile mucopurulent or purulent discharge coming in ESE through a central perforation. Second important feature that you'll see is sagging of posterosuperior meatal wall. If you see in the image over here, this is sagging of posterosuperior meatal wall. This happens because of periosteitis of the bony wall, which lies between the deep posterosuperior part of the bony canal and the antrum. So this is a very, very important feature that you'll see in a case of acute mastoiditis. Next, let's move on to discussing the tympanic membrane. So we'll definitely be seeing a perforation of the tympanic membrane, and usually this perforation is a small one in a pars tensa with congestion of the rest of the tympanic membrane. Sometimes the perforation may appear like a nipple-like protrusion. And sometimes, it is not necessary that you always see a perforation. Sometimes the TM can be intact but dull and opaque, especially in patients who have received inadequate antibiotics. What does inadequate antibiotic mean? It can mean that either the dose was not adequate, or the duration for which it was given, it was not adequate, or the frequency at which it was being given was not adequate. That is when it is known as inadequate antibiotic usage. Next, talking about mastoid. Now, what will we see in mastoid? First important thing that you'll see is mastoid tenderness. This is a very important sign. And how will we elicit this? The tenderness will be elicited by pressure of the middle over the mastoid process at the tip and the posterior border or of the root of zygoma. Tenderness over the supramyatal triangle is not diagnostic, as it is seen even in cases of acute otitis media. And whenever you're noting tenderness, always make sure that you're comparing it with the healthy side. Second, we'll see a swelling over mastoid. Now, initially, what happens? First, there will be an edema of the periosteum. Now, this edema will lead to the development of something known as smooth ironed out feel over mastoid. This is a typical sign that we see, and this is ironed out mastoid. What does this mean and why does it happen? So if you try to normally touch your mastoid in a normal individual, now try to touch it behind your ear, you'll feel that it is a little rough and bumpy. It is not a smooth surface. This is because of all the ridges which are present over it. In a case of mastoiditis, the periosteum undergoes edema, and that is the reason why it looks and feels very smooth. If you see in the third image over here, you can see how smoothened out it looks. It almost feels like there are no ridges over here. So this is a ironed out mastoid. Second, the retroauricular sulcus will become obliterated. You can again see in the same image over here, the retroauricular sulcus does not seem to exist. It has been obliterated. And the pinna gets pushed downwards and forwards. And when pus breaks out through the bony cortex, it leads to the development of a subperiosteal abscess, and which can again burst form a fistula. The first image here, you can see that this is a burst mastoid abscess, and second image shows a mastoid fistula. So these are the mastoid signs that you would see. Coming to hearing loss, we'll find a conductive type of hearing loss, which we can find out by performing tuning fork test. But tuning fork test will only be possible if the child is of more than 7 years age and is not in severe pain. So these are all the clinical features you'll see in a case of mastoiditis. Next, how will we investigate the disease? First of all, performing a complete blood count will show a polymorphonuclear leukocytosis. ESR will be raised because this is an inflammatory process. A performing of the ear swab, if there is a purulent discharge coming out, will help you in finding culture and sensitivity and finding out which antibiotic the patient is susceptible to. And last of all, we can do an X-ray of mastoid or a CT scan of the temporal bone. Here we'll note clouding of the air cells because of the collection of exudate in them. The bony partitions between the air cells become very indistinct. And even you can see a mastoid cavity in later stages when it has progressed further. Coming to treatment, whenever there is a case of acute mastoiditis, the first thing you have to do is immediately hospitalize the patient. Second, we'll start with medical treatment. Now, what are the indications of doing medical treatment? First is if there is an absence of a toxic appearance or signs of intracranial involvement. Second, absence of a post-auricular fluctuation. Third, absence of CT signs of mastoid bone cell destruction. Fourth, a mucosal chronic otitis media and absence of cholesteatoma. In these cases, we can first try out medical treatment. So medical treatment will involve antibiotics. We can start with amoxicillin, ampicillin, or even third generation cephalosporins. And specific antimicrobial can be done after you get the culture sensitivity report. And because there can be a risk of anaerobic organisms causing this as well, we can include chloramphenicol or metronidazole as well. And second, we can use analgesics as and when needed according to the pain that the patient is describing. Now, then next treatment is meningotomy. When do we do meningotomy? We do it when the pus is under tension. We try to relieve it by doing a meningotomy. Very early cases actually respond to conservative treatment with either antibiotics alone or combined with meningotomy. Last method is the surgical method. Now, when will we perform surgery? Usually the surgery that is performed is a cortical mastoidectomy. The indications of cortical mastoidectomy in a case of acute mastoiditis would be subperiosteal abscess when there is a positive reservoir sign. What is reservoir sign? Reservoir sign is when the external auditory canal gets filled immediately with pus after it has been mopped out. So it starts to immediately fill up with pus inside the EAC as you keep mopping it. Third indication is a sagging of the posterior superior meatal wall. Fourth is mastoiditis leading to complications. And last of all, when there's a failure of medical treatment despite using adequate antibiotic for 48 to 72 hours. Our aim of surgery here would be to exenterate all mastoid air cells and remove any pockets of pus. And while after you have done the surgery, you have to make sure that adequate antibiotic treatment is continued for at least 5 days following surgery. So this is all about the treatment of acute mastoiditis. What are the differential diagnoses over here? One is suppuration of the mastoid lymph nodes, which can mimic the situation. Second is furunculosis in EAC. Now, this is something that I've covered in a separate video because this is a very important viva question you are asked as to how will you differentiate between a case of mastoiditis and a furunculosis. You can check out my video about that. Third differential diagnosis is an infected sebaceous cyst. Last part of this is complications of acute mastoiditis. It can basically lead to all the different complications of CSOM, which can be subperiosteal abscess, labyrinthitis, facial palsy, petrositis, septicemia, extradural abscess, subdural abscess, meningitis, brain abscess, lateral sinus thrombophlebitis, and otitic hydrocephalus. So this was about the acute mastoiditis. Next, let's talk about the second type of mastoiditis, which is known as masked or latent mastoiditis. Now, what is masked mastoiditis? This is a condition of slow destruction of the mastoid air cells, but without the acute signs and symptoms that you see in a case of acute mastoiditis. So in this case, there will be no pain, no discharge, no fever, no mastoid swelling. The symptoms appear to be masked. And why? That happens because of the antibiotic coverage. But however, residual disease is still active in the mastoid air cells. So the cause behind acute mastoiditis is inadequate antibiotic therapy in terms of dose, frequency, and duration of administration. Pathology here involves when you perform a mastoidectomy, you'll be able to see that there is extensive destruction of the mastoid air cells with formation of granulation tissue and dark gelatinous material which is filling up the mastoid. And you can even end up seeing an erosion of the tegment tympani and the sinus plate, leading to the formation of extradural and perisinus abscess. Coming to clinical features, you'll see that the child is not feeling well. There will be pain, but it will be a very mild pain behind the ear. There will be a persistent conductive hearing loss. Tympanic membrane may not have a perforation over here. The tympanic membrane may appear thick with loss of translucency. And very slight tenderness can be elicited over mastoid. So you can see how this is very different from all the acute signs and symptoms we were talking about in case of acute mastoiditis. The symptoms are actually very masked over here. Coming to investigation on performing an X-ray mastoid, you will find clouding of the air cells with loss of cellular outline, and pure tone audiometry will show you a conductive hearing loss. And last of all, you can treat it with a cortical mastoidectomy with a full dose of antibiotics. This, because in this case, the tympanic membrane usually doesn't have a perforation, it can actually return the tympanic membrane to normal with an improvement in hearing. So this definitely has a better prognosis than acute mastoiditis. So that's all about mastoiditis. If you have any questions further on it, please note them down in the comment section and I'll get back to you. Thank you.